guys, welcome back to the Blue Milk Show. Today we're going to do a Blue Milk sports show, and we have a very special guest, Wally Jones, a former Philadelphia 76ers. He played for the 67 championship team, one of the best teams, but yes, the 68-13 team, one of the best in NBA history. We're your host. I'm Scotty Too Hotty.
As always, I'm Petey Boy Zane.
And I'm Patrick Toy O'Neill.
How you want to start this, guys?
Pete, kick it off.
Wally, this is Pete here. I want to thank.
How you doing?
I'm well, and yourself?
Doing good, doing good.
First, I want to thank you for coming on your show. This is a tremendous honor for us.
Well, don't mind at all. We got family there, Patrick. As a matter of fact, I tell Patrick I did talk to Nate.
Oh, did you?
My nephew. Yeah, I talked to my nephew. And for our listeners, we had to understand our relationship because my best friend and one of my teammates at Villanova, Richie Moore, played for the Denver Rockets and also played for Villanova when I was at Villanova. So we have a family connection here and glad to be on with you guys.
That's awesome.
And we are excited to have you.
Yes, we are.
I can't thank you enough. Let me get it. Do you mind if I get into asking you questions or
anything? Anything. That's why we're here, so our listeners understand we're about giving news that people can use.
Absolutely.
All right, I got a question. We're a couple of city guys here, West Catholic guys, and we got a guy here from Frankfurt. Let me ask you, who were the toughest guys that you played with in the area?
Well, I'll tell you what, and I'm glad you said that because when you talk about West Catholic, it's quite a connection with Overbrook. Well, it's quite a connection with the public league and then playing against the Catholic league because some of the greatest players that came out of Philly, out of West Catholic, was right around the corner from where I lived at 52nd and Westminster was Jimmy Lynham, Herb McGee, who's one of the winningest coaches at the Philadelphia University. We had Jim Boyle. We had some ball players that Richie Moore even played for West Catholic at one time. One of the few guys that played in the public league and Catholic league was Richie Moore. He played with Earl Monroe at Bartram and played in the Catholic league with West Catholic. So some of the tough guys growing up were guys like Jimmy Lynham, Herb McGee, Steve Corton, Frank Carace. One of the things that we had that was unique in Philadelphia that we would travel to different courts and compete, going into South Philly, Southwest Philly. One of the things that I think that's important was also we're allowed to play industrial ball. So a lot of teams I played for, I played a lot against actual grown men when I was in high school with Walt Hazard and Ralph Hayward. I played for Jim Boyle's father and played for a lot of teams in the Norris League, 5th and Champlos, 25th and Diamond. So Philadelphia basketball was tough. One of the toughest ball players playing against growing up as a high school player was T. Parham and Sonny Hill.
Wow.
They were guys that taught us a lot because they were older than us, and they really taught us a lot. Hal Lear, Guy Rogers, Tom Gola, McNeil. I think about the guys playing in leagues. That's why I mentioned these names, because a lot of leagues I played in, I played against a lot of older ball players that taught us quite a bit. And then I would go up to Haddington and see the greats like Willie Salisbury. Guys from New York would come down and play. So I had a chance to see some of the greatest players in the Will Chamberlain era and the New York area come down and compete. And then to play against the best. We lost a player, and I know I'm talking rapidly about, but it brings so much about a person that just passed away, Connie Hawkins.
Okay.
And see, when I was in high school, the All-Americans from Philly would play against the All-Americans in New York. So I played against Connie Hawkins, Roger Brown, Neil Johnson, guys like Walt Hazard, Tom Hoover, Hubie White. We all went up to New York and played against the best in New York out of high school. So
wow.
It's sort of showing the fraternity and brotherhood of basketball in Philly and also New York. But that wasn't the only thing. They would take the best out of Philly, the D.C., New Jersey, Virginia. So
That's awesome, Wally.
Wally, just to follow up right off of that question, you know, I know you played everywhere in the United States and everything, but what do you think is so different about playing in Philly than anywhere else?
Well, I can give an explanation that we were known. There are a lot of drivers from New York go to basket. We have a reputation for some of the best guards.
Okay.
And one of the greatest guards that ever came out of Philly, Walt Hazard, he was really the Wizard of the West. John Wooden, they call him the Wizard, but the first Wizard was Walt the Wizard because he brought the East Coast style to the West Coast.
Wow.
And a lot of things that we did handling the ball, we learned from Guy Rogers and Bob Cousy, guys that had a little flair and charisma. And our coach allowed us to throw behind our backs. They allowed us to have creativity, should I say, charisma in the game. We created a sort of a style that Walt took out there, and they were the first team for John Wooden with 30-0. We lost to Duke in the regionals, and Hazard called me up and said, we're going to get them. And they beat Duke with Jeff Mullins for the NCAA championship. And he was also named the College Player of the Year. So that gives you an idea about one of the guards that came out of there. But I could give you historically about Earl Monroe breaking all the records at historical black colleges.
Earl the Pearl.
Earl the Pearl.
Bartram, I mean, Boy.
So many guards. Tom Gola. And when you go back to some of the greatest players in the NBA and college ball, you can't forget Tom Gola. See, there's so many guys, they don't remember when we played, they only remember now Magic and Bird and Michael Jordan. They don't know before that. A lot of young people don't know. So that's why I carry films, to let them see the style of play that we play.
Sure.
But, you know, when you talk about Philly ball, there's so many great ball players out of here, and the Big Five was well represented in the NCAAs throughout my college career that we all had. The Big Five teams were great. They always made the NCAA and also were always in the top 25 teams, the Big Five teams. So I'm very proud of that because of Philly basketball, the style of play, the IQ of the basketball players. But we had basketball players that played the game well but shot well. New York was known for driving and going to the hoop. They had some players that could really play in New York, but we always talk about our competition during our high school, college, and pro games against New York.
Okay. Scott, you want to ask a question?
Wally, Scotty, how you doing?
All right, how you doing?
Doing pretty good.
Good.
You know, it's an honor for you on the show. I'm a little nervous talking to you, actually.
Now, somebody said something about Frankfurt.
Yeah, I'm by Frankfurt there. I was just about to ask you. What?
Frankfurt, well, I'll tell you what. The guy that had the best teams out of Frankfurt is Vince Miller, Will Chamberlain's best friend.
Wow.
Dang.
When we won the world championship in 67, they didn't have five or six assistant coaches. There was only one coach. Vince Miller was like the assistant coach. Vince Miller was a mentor to me because he played with my brother and Al Addles at A&T. He's an overbroken champion with Wilt. But Frankfurt had some great teams coached by no other than Vince Miller. God bless his soul, he passed away. But there's so much connection when you talk about the areas where you guys are from.
Yeah.
So much is part of Philly ball, man.
Yeah,
growing up, we're all rivals here.
I got you.
Just a question.
What do you think of the players today? And the game, the game style and the rules.
I like the creativity, the skill level. Skill levels are fantastic for it. It goes all the way down to from one to five. And when you talk about fives, you got five that are shooting three pointers. They just Pau Gasol. I didn't know that he shot 50%. From the three-point line last year. But ball players are now stretch fours, fives are shooting. Three-pointers were doing our area. All our big men were inside.
Yeah.
We were more physical. We're allowed to have our hands on. They don't allow that anymore. So the game is more wide open. And it's sort of the style that I played when I was in the ABA with Utah Stars. The ABA game is just like what the Golden State Warriors do. We were the ones, when I went in 75 for Utah with Moses Malone, they were shooting three-pointers. Doc, Jordan McGinnis, you see big men running up shooting threes because that was a style of play that now all the teams are adjusting to. Tonight when the Sixers play, they must have had around 15 to 16 actual three-pointers.
Wow.
Yeah. So you see, you don't run to the basket on a fast break, three-on-one, three-on-two. You run to the three-point line. So that's where the game has changed. It's exciting. I like the style of play. Guys are creative. There's still tremendous athletes and skill levels, but it's a little more wide open because it was mostly from inside out.
Wow.
Yeah,
and we throw it into a center, and I think I'm the only ball player that played with the greatest centers ever. Walt Bellamy, Will Chamberlain, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, Moses Malone, Dal Dawkins, Bob Lanier. I just named eight guys who are the greatest centers that ever played.
Wow, that's impressive, Wally.
That is impressive. I don't think anybody's ever played with guys that nature. People don't know who Walt Bellamy was, but he was one of the greatest centers that played during his time from Indiana.
Oh,
I played
with
him with the Baltimore Bullets.
Let me go on your end.
No, go ahead.
I do have one more. How was it playing against Bill Russell?
Bill Russell was tough. And like Will Chamberlain said, it wasn't a duel between Bill Russell and Will. As Will said, hey, I'm playing against the Boston Celtics. They had a team.
Right.
And because of their team, the way they played, and because he anchored their defense, he anchored their fast break. And I liked him so much that I asked Jack Kraft if we could wear black Converses when I went to Villanova. Because I was a fan of the Boston Celtics, the way they played. Even though I'm from Philly, and I watched those games when Wilt and Paul Harris and Woody Salisbury, those old-timers. But I was a fan of Boston because of the style they played. They ran the wide-open, good defense. And after they won eight in a row and we finally beat them, you know, it was something all the NBA teams were so happy because it was such a dynasty. They just dominated 8 years in a row.
Well,
until you came.
Yeah, that's right. We got them.
Piggybacking off of that there, Wally, I got a question for you. Now, you just ran off a list of eight guys who were great centers. They were great underneath the basket. Now, in my personal opinion, now I'm a little younger, I think that Shaq is the greatest big man in the game. Let me ask you what your opinion is on that.
Well, you know, I know how they rate guys, and again, when you talk about skill level, you got a guy like Kareem, not only the leading scorer, but how many championships he won. Then you look at guys that even that were dominant as a dominant player that ever played the game. The greatest basketball, individual basketball, is Will Chamberlain because of all the records and what he's done. They'll never be broken, what he did, averaging 50 points, 24 rebounds. A guy that, I'm not just talking about the 100-point game. I'm talking about statistically, he has more statistics when you look it up of any player ever as an individual.
Right.
Because in my book, Black Champions Challenge America Sports, which I wrote with Jim Washington, I rated Bill Russell as one of the greatest because of what he did with eight championships. So
yeah.
A lot of people rate people individual, and a lot of people rate guys because of their championships. And Shaq was one of the greatest centers ever. I mean, one of the greatest centers ever. And he had, and I can't say four, maybe he had four championships. Maybe he had five.
No, he had, I believe it's four. But
yeah, and I was here when he won. I have a ring of that championship when he was with the Heat because I was a scout for him. I was community relations. So I was here when Shaq, Dwayne, Gary Payton,
Ray Allen,
White Chocolate, Jason Williams.
Yeah, Jason Williams, yeah.
Mike Miller. I mean, I was here. So, I mean, you know, I worked for him. So I saw
was
Shaq. This was his later year, but
right.
You know, his championships in L.A. with Kobe, fantastic, man.
Well, I was just going to ask you that. I have one more question about that subject. This is just a hypothetical. What if Shaq and Kobe would have stayed together? Do you think Shaq would be in the conversation for the greatest big man of all time? Because
because I believe they would have won some more.
Yeah.
You know, even though both of them won individually without each other, they're two great players. And you surround great players like that with complimentary players, and they can bring you a championship. And I think that's what happened with Wilt, because after we had 68-13, we were named the NBA's greatest team. This is our 50th year anniversary. Yep. I have to tell our listeners.
We have the T-shirt NBA's right in front of us team, right now.
Yeah, the NBA's greatest team for the first 35 years, but this is our 50th anniversary. Now, when Wilt went to L.A. with the greatest players, and Jerry West, Elgin, Gil, Goodrich, guys like that, they were 69-13.
Wow.
So when you look at Wilt Chamberlain, what he did in that era, and what he did individually, anybody can talk about individuals like Michael winning six. You got some guys that are some of the greatest players ever. But individually, there will never be a basketball player to individually do anything statistically like Wilt Chamberlain. I don't think it'll ever be done again.
Wow.
Never. I really don't.
Well, I got a question. A buddy of mine that played high school ball in the city. His name's Kevin Haney. He's from Southwest Philly as well. He asked, as a former NBA player, what are your thoughts on the resting players culture that has been sweeping through the NBA?
Well, one thing they have to look at, and of course we didn't think of that. Matter of fact, we won a championship. Chet Walker gave me the stat that everybody played 82 games, but Al Greer missed one game.
Wow.
There was a lot of pressure to compete, even when you were hurt during our time, because the limited players that you had, limited teams. So sometimes you were shot up to play when you had injuries, and that's why a lot of guys hit new knees. You were forced to play because they try to keep you on the court, no matter what. If you got hurt, now it's a fingernail, or they got a rest. These guys are, Professor Anthony's paying a lot of money, but what's going to happen is some games back-to-back, because the recovery periods, that's why you have injuries, because the schedules are tough, but it's been done for years and years, but it's a new era. They rest their players so they can be ready for the playoffs.
Right.
What was it
like? It's too many games. I have to say this, just a point blank. It's too many games, and they've cut down on the back-to-backs, but your recovery period is just, it's not enough recovery time. Right. And these big athletes, as you saw last night, anything can happen.
Oh, yeah.
In a game, but what's happening with fatigue or guys that are playing so many games, it's important to realize that you have a recovery period. Travel. You travel across country, it's so much to wear and tear on your body.
Right.
That people don't really understand professional sports. They're some of the best conditioned athletes in the world are basketball players.
Okay.
All right, Wally, I only have one more question for you. In your own opinion, who's your top favorite NBA players of all time? Or not just NBA, players in general that you've played with in your career?
Well, when you talk about, there's so many styles and so many positions. You don't know, I admired the way Oscar Robertson played. I had a chance to play with him in Milwaukee with Kareem and Bobby Damps and Lucius Allen. I mean, there's some great players. I had a chance to play when you talk about Utah and the ABA, a kid named Moses Malone. You know, come in there and dominate. I mean, we made the playoffs because of a 19-year-old kid. So there's different types of players that I play with and against and with. There's just so many types that I really admire games. The passing of Connie Hawkins, one of the great players of all time. His style of play was way before Doc. He was the Dr. J before Dr. J.
Wow. And nobody really knows about that either.
Pardon me?
I said, nobody really knows about that either.
Yeah, well, some people used to write for the New York Post or the New York Daily News.
Yes.
A lot of guys that know the history and have seen guys that play, my goodness, you can see the type of ball players that really dominate the game, that revolutionize the game. Well, Connie Hawkins was the guy that did the flying and graceful dunks and handling the ball like it was a grapefruit.
Wow.
But, you know, when you look at him and Wilt, the guys in the center, they played for the Globetrotters, and people didn't know these guys could pass the ball and see passing because they played with the Globetrotters. I'm talking about palming the ball, going through our system. Why we won a championship, go in the Wilt, and we cut, and he would find you. The same thing with Bill Walton and the 77 Portland Trailblazers. Cool, they had Jack Ramsey coached them.
Yes.
He was our general manager. He used the same system that we had when we won a championship in Portland.
Get out, really?
Right in the center. So a lot of people know ball. When you talk about great players, oh, I couldn't even. There's so many great ones. So many great ones that I enjoy playing with and against.
Wow.
I mean, great ones.
All right, well, I got another question for you, buddy. If you played in the NBA today, which superstar would you like to play with, and which superstar would you like to play against?
Well, here's what I look at. Anybody that played with LeBron James, you want to play with some of the greatest. Just like I was so happy to play with Oscar Robertson. Here you're playing with a guy that, now I'm a guard, but here's a guy that just knows how to fundamentally get you the ball. If I played in the NBA now, I'd have thousands of more points because of the three-point shot.
Right.
I didn't get a chance to shoot three-pointers until 1975 when I went to Utah in the ABA.
Oh, wow.
So my career would have been quite different because that's where I shot from a lot. And a lot of things that I look at the game today, oh, man, so many guys. When you look at competition, I hated playing Calvin Murphy and Tiny Archibald.
Wow.
Because they were just as fast. And guys I look at that are small, that are quick, it's a challenge. See, I like the competition. And I could look at guys like CP3, you know, small guards that are quick. And Tony, I mean, guys like that, you want that competition. Tony Parker, I'm looking at guys that are about my size. I'm only 6'1". And people tell me when they see me, they thought I was bigger. I'm looking at Jeff Teague, excellent player that plays for Minnesota now.
Yeah.
These guys are quick. They handle the ball. They run the team. So those are challenges. These are the guys that I'd be playing against if I was playing today. I mean, great players. There's so many other small guards that can handle that ball and pass and shoot. But it'd be something to be in this area. Just a different style of play.
Wally, following up right after that question, which current player do you consider to be a throwback to your generation of players?
I'll give you a guy, and it's pretty interesting when you look at how they play. Rookie of the Year, I saw him come in. His name is Brogdon. He won the Rookie of the Year. He went to Virginia, played 4 years of college. And he's a throwback fundamental. He's a rookie that did not look like a rookie because he played the way like Walt Frazier would play.
Wow.
You have good defense, set up the team, take a good shot. He plays at a great pace. He just reminds me of one of the old-timers. Different style of play, but a guy that you can look at and say, man, he looks like one of those old-school guards like Walt. I mean, Walt Frazier's consistent, handling the ball. Running the team, very good defensive player. So those things like that, when I see comparisons, I see that in a young player. I'm just looking at young players now, but I enjoyed looking at Ben Simmons tonight. Reminds me a lot of Magic.
Wow.
And a lot of talented players with basketball IQ. When I talk about IQ, these guys got some talent.
Wow. That's awesome.
They got talent.
So, The day you won the championship, what was it like in the locker room?
We went on the road. We run in Oakland, and Billy Cunningham and I talked about this, about some of the things that are happening now about treating people the way you should be treated. We talked about a lot of issues that involve treating people fairly. And the reason I'm saying is because when we were playing basketball, we had summer jobs. We didn't make that much money. And we were doing clinics all over Philly. And we would be together all over Northeast, South Philly, West, Delaware, Atlantic City.
Wow.
We were visible in all communities because we had to work. But we talked about really how we were visible and equality. We actually talked about people being treated the same. He's an interesting, very close friend of mine, Billy Cunningham. He gave me the job down here with the Miami Heat. And the friendship and brotherhood of guys that think the way we think about treating people the way they should be treated and equality. The same thing they're fighting for now, we're fighting for that then. So it's really no different. It's unfortunate that a lot of things, sports can have guys pull together for political reasons, but I'm talking about just for human reasons, for equal rights, treating people fair. I think that's so important in our society, and it's so unfortunate now that so much hate is coming out.
Wally, we're getting pressed for time right now. Tell us a little bit about your charity work and also the radio show that you host.
Well, good point. I'd like to get on that. I work with Sports Inside and Out. This is our fifth year. We broadcast at the NCAA Super Bowl, the NBA All-Star Games. We are the voice of the retired players.
Oh, that's great.
SportsInsideAndOut.com. We report on all our chapters around the United States of retired players. And I'm also just had a showing 2 weeks ago of a documentary I helped produce called The Dreammaker. That's the owner, Earl Foreman, who owned the Squires.
Okay.
And he owned the Eagles. But Dr. J, George Gervin, Charlie Scott, all those guys are there. Day Towards It. They were all there in Norfolk for that. So I'm in the business of radio and documentary and also working in the community in Philadelphia, Glenn Mills, and working at rec centers all around trying to help kids in Philly.
What's the name of the charity work that you do, Wally?
All right. Our thing is they can go online, shootforthestarslegends.org.
Okay. Awesome. Wally, thanks for taking your time. We really appreciate it.
Wally, my head is spinning. Thank you so much for this.
Yes.
No problem. Hey, man, so you got to get me back again, and we'll talk extensively how we can pull things together to help in our community, because we can use your vehicle of communication also to talk about community service.
Absolutely.
Yes, absolutely, Wally.
We would love to do it.
Yeah, we'll definitely stay in touch.
All right. Have a good time, man. Thank you. I enjoyed it. And Patrick, thanks for inviting me.
No problem. Anytime, Wally. Thank you.
All right, man.
Honor.
All right.
Have a good one.
Peace. See you later.
All right.
Peace. All right, guys. See you later. And until next time,
may the scores
be with you.
Be with you.